Hi everybody, we will see now the fusion reactions. Earlier we learned what the plasma was and also we did some analysis about how the plasma particles move around. We solved some equations and we saw that there are electrons and negative and positive ions moving all over and they are doing the collisions and all these phenomena were governed by some kind of equations which are called magnetohydrodynamics equations, which consists of the fluid equations, okay, plus Maxwell's equations. So by solving these fluid and Maxwell's equations together, we ended up with MHD problems. And by using this, you can analyze many things. For instance, the thing that we analyzed was sending some kind of signal with some specific frequency, okay, some electric and magnetic fields, of course, and then see if there is a resonance or if there are some collisions or some propagation properties or just reflection or absorption and things like that. So we have seen this by using the MHD equations, and the very nice example that we have done was that the signals that went to ionosphere, which is actually weakly ionized plasma, these signals that you sent actually did something in, with the plasma, interacted with the plasma particles, usually electrons, of course, and then the propagation just changed. So in order to understand the propagation properties of these signals, we said that W, which is 2 pi F, which is the frequency, F is the frequency and W is the angular frequency, and also K, which is 2 pi over lambda. So there is no linear dependence usually with the plasma, okay? And omega function of K, omega is a function of K, is not really linear, so that the speed changes according to this graph. And then we have seen that for ionosphere we had this kind of dependence where there is a cutoff frequency. It means that there is no propagation here. No propagation. So if a wave cannot propagate in this region, it can only get reflected. Okay? If there is no propagation, it can get reflected. But in this region where above some kind of frequencies, the waves can propagate and so on. So these were the basic characteristics about the plasma. And also in earlier parts of the lecture, we learned how these particles moved around and we solved some equations, under the influence of electric and magnetic fields, okay? We investigated the motion of the particles and we saw that usually there are spiral motions and some other kind of acceleration and deceleration depending on the electric and magnetic fields we saw or external forces. Now, we would like to see if it's possible that we have a fusion in the lab. Actually, in nature, sun is nothing but the plasma, okay? And it has fusion reactions inside. Fusion means getting together. So actually it's a nuclear reaction because sun is so hot that unlike ionosphere that we have around Earth, sun is so hot so that all the electrons are sucked off from the atoms. And you cannot really find neutral atoms. It's all ions and electrons, okay? So this is the reason that we have fully ionized plasma. So it's fully ionized. So inside we have non-neutrals, plus charges, minus charges and electrons. That's it. Of course, different kind of nuclei. So these are negative and positive nuclei, and also we have electrons. Okay, so in this case, continuously there are some fusion reactions. The first fusion reaction is called DD reaction, okay? DD reaction is deuterium plus deuterium. So deuterium is atomic number one and mass number two plus another deuterium, okay? When they fuse together, okay? But this can only happen when you give some kind of heat. So you have to give a big amount of heat in order this to happen. So the temperatures must be very high, just like in the sun or just on the outer parts of the sun. Actually, we can in the lab, we can reach to these temperatures, okay? The surface of the sun. We can reach to these kind of temperatures in the lab, so we can create this kind of deuterium-deuterium reaction. If one deuterium is combined with another one, helium is produced, and the 2-3, helium 2-3, and its energy is 0.8 MeV. As you see, this is an enormous amount of energy. So in order to create this kind of thing, you have to give lots of heat in the order of a few MeVs, okay? So unless you give this, there is no way that you can get the fusion reaction. Also, you can do these fusion reactions in the lab by just applying millions of volts or just moving the energies of these deuterium isotopes, okay, to very high velocities so that their energies are really in the order of a few MeVs. And also the another species that is produced from this chemical reaction is just neutron. And neutron happens to have lots of energy, 2.4 MeV. So as you see, this fusion reaction, two small nuclei got combined and then created a heavier nuclei and a neutron is produced. And this neutron is extremely hot, by the way. So helium, as you see, is just a gas and it's not harmful, so that you can also use this helium to create some other things. Anyway, there is another reaction. There is another reaction, which is a DT reaction. It's called DT reaction. So one deuterium and one tritium. Okay, tritium, 1-3, fuses together and then creates helium, but helium with mass number 4. It means there is one more neutron inside, neutron. So that in the nucleus. So that the energy is 2.5 MeV, great amount of energy it has. And the neutron is even extremely more energetic and it's 14.1 MeV. So it means that DT reactions produces much bigger energy because not only neutrons, but also helium. These are, by the way, this is alpha particle, right? This is also alpha particle, but one neutron is missing from its nucleus. So this alpha particle. And it's really radioactive, of course. You have to be careful with this, but there is a way that you can get this helium to produce some other things. Okay? So these are DD and DT reactions. And also this is called this is 3.2 MeV total, and it's called neutron branch because it's probable that this reaction has also another probability of producing different kind of things. Okay, what is that? This produces tritium, okay, and this tritium is about 1 MeV, and then one proton. This proton is 3 MeV. So in total, this is about 4 MeV in total, and it's called proton branch. So there is a probability of these reactions. So you never know if you fuse the two deuterons actually, because deuterium is the atom and deuteron is the nucleus. So if two deuterons are fused, then either helium or tritium are produced, or neutron and proton produced. Okay, so there is some probability, and approximately the probability is approximately 50% for each. So, okay, so there is a probability that each one of them is probable. Okay, sometimes this happens, sometimes this happens in these reactions. You never know. But DT reactions producing only one kind of product, which is a very energetic neutron, and also alpha particle, again very energetic. Also, we can do another reaction with deuterium. So this helium, which has one neutron missing, okay, can be combined with the deuterium deuterons. So DHE reaction, okay, it's called DHE reaction, deuterium helium reaction. So one deuteron can be combined with the helium, okay, and it produces regular alpha particle, okay, neutral alpha particle with 3.7 MeV, okay, and a proton. So it means that this is getting more and more radioactive. So this is radioactive. This is highly radioactive. As you will remember, radioactive things always decay to lower elements. So if there is tritium around, it will decay into deuterium. And then if there is a deuterium, it will decay into hydrogen. Actually, all atoms will decay one after another until going back to hydrogen, which was the initial atom that was created at the Big Bang. Okay, now, for instance, uranium with 238, atomic number 238 exists, which is the heaviest isotope. Okay, but earlier in the universe, we had some kind of element which has like 500 or 600, okay, mass number. So by decaying years and years later, we now ended up with uranium 238. But after a few thousand years later, there will be no more uranium because all of them will be having radiated into or decaying into smaller, lighter nuclei. Okay. So all of these things will decay until everything comes back down to hydrogen. Okay. Anyway, this is just going to happen like millions and maybe thousands and millions of years later. But now we have to really understand how this mechanism is working. So can we do this reaction in somewhere? Yes. Okay. There are many ways. There are many experimental facility in which you can produce fusion. Okay. So what are they? Let's check. Russian physicists try to create fusion reactions in a vacuum chamber, okay, by using two techniques. One is magnetically confined. Magnetically confined fusion. The other is inertially confined fusion. Of systems like so, okay, like toroidal. This is a good. This is just a trying to get the best out. If mirrors of the inside this region, like bagel or simit in Turkish, okay, like that. But the plasma shouldn't touch the walls, and this is because there is a curvature. It's not easy, okay? It's not easy. So now, magnetically confined fusion devices always use some kind of coils, okay? For this one, for instance, you can use this kind of toroidal and also this kind of poloidal coils. Okay, but now earlier these coils were outside the vacuum chamber. Of course, you have to get everything under vacuum, otherwise it doesn't work. But the efficiency of these coils that produced the magnetic fields was not so high. But Lockheed Martin, the American company, just created a fusion by using spherical reactor by keeping the these coils inside the vacuum chamber. So they achieved really very nice results, and it's very exciting because once we have fusion reactions initiated, we can get enormous amount of energy, and this by this way, okay, we can really get electricity cheaper, and also a big amount of energy can be produced. So this is really ultimate goal of physicists, to create a big amount of fusion reactions, so that we can get a break even, and from this we can get enormous amount of energy. The efficiency of this nuclear reactor, which is working under the fusion reactions, actually the efficiency will be very close to one. Usually any power plants that we are using now, it can be coal, it can be thermic electric, or it can be natural gas power plant, or any kind of power plant, the efficiency of the mechanical efficiency of the of these reactors that produce electricity is in the order of like 30%, 40%, 50%, 60% the most. But these, if these things work, it will be more than 90% or something. It will be extremely efficient. So you have to give just a little bit of energy in order to keep these reactions going until right after it starts. So Lockheed Martin, please check the literature and see that Lockheed Martin company in America created a very nice spherical tokamak. And this is, by the way, toroidal device is called tokamak. So for cylinders, they use coils right in the beginning and in the end. Also, there are coils here also, but these are very intense coils that you use because they would like to get rid of the exiting these plasma particles, outside the interior, okay? But usually, these mirror machines were not very successful because there were lots of escapes, although very strong magnetic field, which creates some kind of reflection for these plasma particles created, but some of them also escaped. So there is no way that they could get rid of this escape. But so when they combine this together, so they just put they ended up with some kind of toroidal chamber. In this toroidal chamber, there is no exit, so that the plasma particles have nowhere to go. So there is no way that there is the escape. But because of the curvature and also conservation of the angular momentum require that because of the curvature there are Coriolis forces so that the plasma wants to expand outside, okay? So in order to eliminate this, they used different kind of coils. One coil like this, okay? So a big current just passed through this interior in the middle, okay? So the current, so lots of coils, one after another like that, okay? So this current created a toroidal magnetic field like this, B toroidal magnetic field because of this current, high current. Okay, these currents are like millions of amperes, believe me, it's huge. So the toroidal magnetic field can be created by this kind of field, but also they use different kind of coils like this, okay, sideways, just on the top like this, right? And then because the current passes through these coils like that, the magnetic field that is created are like poloidal, right? Bipoloidal. So now we have toroidal and poloidal fields together so that these two magnetic fields combine and create some kind of region like a net around the plasma, okay? So there is always spiral motion like this. The magnetic field lines will be covering, okay, the plasma. All the plasma particles will be kept inside because of this toroidal and poloidal magnetic field. So, but in order to create this kind of high toroidal and poloidal magnetic fields, you need enormous amount of currents in the order of like kilo amperes or even mega amperes, okay? So, but this is very difficult technologically. Usually the tokamak power plant, okay, use this energy input using capacitor banks, okay? Capacitor banks. So you can put lots of capacitors one after another and also just load, just charge them up, and then all of their energies are just given with a switch. This is called circuit breaker, by the way, not easy. Circuit breaker, because you're talking about thousands and millions of amperes, and no switch can handle this. That's why you have to have some kind of circuit breaker system in which there is some gases here, so the plasma actually turns this on and off, and then the energy is given to the coils, to these coils, and also the other poloidal coils. So when this energy is given, the plasma is of course, first you create the plasma by putting some kind of gas and injecting some kind of energy, and then you apply this toroidal and poloidal field, and then you squeeze the plasma. As soon as you squeeze the plasma, so this cross section just reduces to, suppose that in earlier the cross section of the plasma was like that, but after the compression the cross section just becomes like this, very small, tiny, but because all the particles come together and then fusion starts. A big amount of neutrons are detected. So they put detectors around this inside walls, and the number of neutrons that are detected by these detectors just show that there are fusion reactions. There are fusion reactions, and also the level of the fusion reactions can be measured by counting neutrons by some kind of special detectors. So these are all magnetically confined fusion. But there is also inertial confined fusion, which is possible, and they use lasers for this, okay, lasers. So inertial confined fusion, so they have, I know that, you know, in Ann Arbor, in America, Michigan, there is a company, I guess it was Arbor Corporation or something, they produce these kind of pellets, okay, these pellets. This pellet is in the order of about 5 millimeters in radius, okay, or diameter or something. You know, it's very small. It's like very small, okay, smaller than this fingernail, okay? So inside they put D and T gas, okay, these pellets. So these pellets have incredible amount of deuterium and tritium gases together, which do not do any reactions, or also they also produce some kind of just pellets by having only the deuterium inside. Okay, so only D. Okay, only D2. But here they also put D and tritium, which is not easy to produce. The tritium is highly radioactive. You have to produce it. But the deuterium, this is obtained from heavy water, which is D2O, which is heavy water. And believe me, on the bottom of Black Sea in Turkey is full of this heavy water. And you can get deuterium from heavy water down in the Black Sea or some other places, of course. And by using this, you can get fusion reactions and you can solve the energy problem, of course. It's very important. So we have to be really strategic to keep our okay, our or limits in Black Sea. So what the company name was, but you can just see that you can find this from internet. They produce these pellets. What happens is that these pellets are just used one at a time. So there is a conveyor belt or something which moves continuously, okay, through some kind of structure, okay, and then there are pellets on it, and then when they come to a target region, a laser just is shot, okay, very intense lasers, okay, just similar laser, okay, just concentrates only in this. So because of this high laser impact, okay, the whole system, including the walls, just is compressed. Okay, it implodes. Implosion happens. Implosion. Actually, you remember explosion? For explosion, the particles just go explode outside, but implosion, they explode inside. So it means that they just, from this, their size gets reduced, and their size reduces, and a very small, okay, they get very small because of the effect of laser. And then because the laser is continuously coming, actually it's not continuous, it's just a matter of a few milliseconds maybe, but this is a really long amount of time in order to create diffusion. And then after this energy is produced, the new pellet comes here, and then another shining laser. But this laser is like megajoules of lasers, you know. This is not easy. So you need like buildings and buildings to create this high level, high power laser. Not only you have to create this, but also after creating laser, you can just get the laser from different channels, so that you can use these channels to focus into one point, okay, like that. This is technologically extremely difficult, okay, but there are laboratories that are doing this in Russia, in Japan, in Europe, and also in the US, okay? So hopefully one day we will also do this thing. So this, because of this implosion, a big amount of fusion is created, and then neutrons are produced, and also all these reactions that I showed you in the beginning of this lecture, all these protons, alpha particles, and other species are produced, okay, in the reactions. So a big amount of heat, of course, always is obtained. Always big amount of Q is obtained, okay? Big amount of heat. So this heat can be used, okay, this Q can be used to heat the water to create steam. And this steam, actually steam, goes through some kind of heat transfer to the turbines, and then you create electricity. That's it. So basically, in order to create electricity, you use the heat that is coming from the fusion reactions. not from the coal, not from the natural gas, not from any other source of heat, okay? So this is really interesting. And don't forget, if you control atomic bomb, if you control it, you get nuclear reactor, nuclear fission reactor, okay? Fission means to disintegrate into smaller nuclei. So a heavy nucleus, just for instance, uranium just goes into xenon plus krypton, okay? So plus some other materials, neutrons, okay? So heavier particle creates two smaller particles in nuclear fission reaction. So if you can control atomic bomb, you can get nuclear fission reactor. But if you control hydrogen bomb, which is like thousands of times stronger than atomic bomb, if you can control this, you can get nuclear, okay, fusion reactor. Probably tokamak, because it is the tokamak or spherical tokamak. Like Lockheed Martin is working on, okay? Don't forget, tokamak comes from Russian, and Russians are the ones who created the first tokamak, okay? So they are excellent scientists. So if you can really control the hydrogen energy, fusion means fusing, but this is disintegration. So you can get enormous amount of energy, as I have explained earlier. Okay, good. So now I would like to talk about some physics. Okay, some physics. So remember that there are some neutrons produced in the system, but also we would like to use neutrons, okay, because neutrons are not directly used to heat the water. But now what happens is that this fusion plants usually use lithium in the interior wall, okay? They put some kind of lithium. Lithium is extremely important, okay? Because you can create batteries and things like that. But also, look what happens when you have lithium. One neutron, if a neutron hits the lithium, do you know what happens? The neutron, there is a chemical reaction, and then you create an alpha particle, regular alpha particle, neutral, plus tritium. Wow, it's interesting. Because you can use this tritium as the fuel, plus 4.6 MeV. A big amount of energy is produced. So if you use lithium blankets, this is called lithium blanket, okay, so you can get rid of the radioactivity business, because neutrons are highly radioactive, because they don't have any, there is no way that you can have barriers for the neutrons, because they don't have charges. So it's better that you allow the lithium interaction, so that when you cover the interior of the plasma fusion plant by lithium, and allow the neutrons to hit and get this reaction, you can create alpha particles, which is the gas, alpha particle, and also in the form of gas. So you can just collect these gases somewhere, and then this is not alpha particle, it's just a helium nucleus, is not very dangerous. You can just easily process it to give into the air. But now the thing is that tritium is produced. So when the tritium is produced, you can put this for D and T reactions, so that you can use a fuel. You can use this as the fuel. So from this reaction, you can produce tritium, and then you can put this tritium again in the system, so that the efficiency is even increased. So it's extremely important that you have lithiums. So now what happens? Suppose that we have now one atom, okay, which is neutral reacting nuclei, reacting nuclei, both of them are stationary. So this is number one and number two. So what are they? Maybe this is deuterium and tritium, or deuterium and deuterium. So this is rest. They are rest. They are at rest. They don't have to move very fast, but they just fuse into each other. So when they do that, according to conservation of momentum, okay, in earlier zero velocities, okay, V1 is equal to zero, and V2 is also equal to zero, so that we have plus zero, which is equal to now M3, V3 final, V initial velocities, like initial V1 initial, V2 initial zero, M3, why we have M3? This is M1 and M2, because the masses changed, you know, masses changed. The product, the masses of these products are different than the masses of the input. This is output products and this is input. So if this is M1 and this is M2, this is M3 and this is M4, by the way. So, but for DT reaction, we say D plus T, which is alpha particle plus hydrogen, remember, plus some kind of energy. So this is M1, this is M2, this is M3, and this is M4. But now, this is before collision, this is after collision. So before collision, there is no momentum. So it's like these gas particles actually are not moving very fast, and they are just touching each other. Because of the compression that you create by the external fields, they just touch each other and then fuse. And now, but now because new particles are created, of course they will have some kind of momentum. They will move with some kind of velocity. So this is before, and then this is after. After M3 and M4 are produced, but probably they move in opposite directions. V3 final, and this is V4 final with this kind of velocity. Because initially, because they are at rest, they should move in opposite directions through the conservation of momentum. So anyway, if you look at that, we have M4 plus M4 V4F, okay, which should be zero. As you see from here, you see that M3 V3 final should be equal to minus M4 V4 final. This is exactly what I have told you. So one of the velocity will be in opposite to the other velocity. So they are opposite. They are going to be in opposite directions, just like I have drawn. But if there are particles that are moving together and then fusing, then the products also can move in the same direction. Because when they have initial velocity, the final things also will have similar direction. But here, there is nothing. So according to the conservation of momentum, we have to get total momentum zero right after the collision, which requires that one of the velocity will be totally in opposite directions. Also, the conservation of energy. Okay, so we know that one of mv square. So from this we can write, okay, m3 times m3 v final 3 squared. So if you just get this, as you see, this is just the energy, okay? So this will be equal to 1 over 2 M4, okay, V final 4 square, multiplied by M4, okay? We can do that from this expression, okay? We can take squares and, okay, we get now, when you get squares of both sides, as you see, when we get squares, we have M3 square, V3F square, and we have M4 square, V4F square. But now the minus sign cancels because we squared it, and then we just divide everything by half, and then we see that their kinetic energies will be different, right? So kinetic energy of the third particle after the collision, M3, okay, will be equal to kinetic energy of the fourth particle times M4. So their kinetic energies will be related to each other except there is a mass ratio. So K3, for instance, will be equal to M4 over M3 times K4. So the kinetic energies of these particles will not be the same, and the proportion or just the relative values depend on the masses actually. These masses, for instance, alpha particle and helium may be twice as, maybe four times as heavier because this is four and this is one, right? So the kinetic energy of the hydrogen will be four times greater than this because of the mass differences, okay? Good. So we learned that also total energy basically is distributed between these two particles, right? So this is something that we learned. And another thing that I would like to tell you is the reaction rates. Okay, reaction rates. Reaction rates, we know that like if N1 species and N2 species are interacting fusion reaction, there are some products, let's say, products. And then we would like to get the reaction rate, okay, because this is very important. Reaction rate, which is R, is given by N1 times N2, okay, times sigma times velocity. Okay, but now this actually this is just the average value, so that you can also write this as N1, N2, which is the number of reacting nuclei, okay, multiply by sigma v, but you get average cross section. So this sigma is the cross section. Actually, its unit is meter square. And this velocity, right? This is the velocity. So reaction rate has this kind of dependence. Now, it's possible that N1 and N2, the number of particles can be the same. Then we get N square over 2, right? In this case, if N1 is equal to N2, then the reaction rate is just N square, N1 square over 2 times sigma times velocity, okay? So sigma is the cross section. So why cross section is important? Because, you know, each atom has some kind of size, and if any other atom is just coming and interacting with it, so for instance, if it, this is the cross section of the surface area of the atom. So if it moves like that, it's really probable that this, the second nucleus, suppose this N1 and this is N2, which is moving with some kind of velocity, there is a possibility that this will collide. But now, if this is happening, of course, this is a head-on collision, but there are some cases in which this can just go without colliding, okay? But because there is an interaction, usually what happens is that this gains a little bit momentum in opposite direction, and this resting N2 particles will also move some kind of momentum because of just interaction. See, as you see, this is not a direct interaction, but indirect interaction through some charges, Coulomb forces maybe or something. So basically, the reaction rates are always given by this kind of cross-section. And this cross-section is not constant value. The cross-section, this cross-section depends on the energy, incoming energy, okay? So maybe it has some kind of resonances or something like that. This is not easy to get this cross-section. The cross-section is not a constant thing, but for different energies, it, any material will give different kind of cross-sections, which are found in the labs by doing heavy intensive experiments, and many cross-sections for the cross-sections of many atoms are already found in the literature. You can find them. Okay. Now, by using this reaction rates, we can also get the kinetics of nuclei. Okay, how can we do this? How can we do this by using this definition? So we know that if we have DD reaction, the result is that either we have helium 3 plus neutron or tritium plus proton. This is like almost 50% probability. But if we have D plus T, we have just products, alpha particle plus one neutron. But if we have D plus helium, okay, we have helium 3, by the way, this is, we get helium 4, which is alpha particle, okay, which is alpha particle and plus hydrogen, okay, hydrogen. So now what's happening is that suppose that all of these reactions are happening inside the system. Suppose that all these reactions are happening inside fusion system, let's say. For instance, sun, or tokamak, or etc. Whatever the fusion power plant you are using, okay. In this case, we know that there is a deuterium source, okay, source of deuterium. So SD is the source of deuterium because you have to give deuterium, okay, inside the system. And ST is the source of tritium. Tritium. Maybe you can get this tritium by using neutrons interacting with the lithium blanket, and then you can put this tritium, S tritium, right? So you have to inject some kind of tritium continuously because these are burning and you need fuel continuously, right? And also S helium is the source of helium. Of helium. Okay? So the time rate of the change of the deuterium dN over dt will be directly related to okay, SD, because this is increasing the number continuously, positive, but minus number one reaction, due to number one reaction, minus number two reaction, minus number three reaction. What are these reactions here? This is number one reaction, this is number two reaction, number three reaction. As you see, these are all lost because if this reaction happens, two of the deuterions are lost. It is loss, right? This is also loss of deuterium. This is also loss of deuterium. Okay. But now what about the tritium? D and T over DT. Of course, we have the tritium source, which is ST. Okay. And then the first one, first reaction, you get one tritium as an output. As you see in 1, 2, 3, no output is produced. No deuterium is produced here. So that there is no contribution to the number of deuteriums of the products. But now, as the product, tritium is produced here, only through number one. So now, number one is the gain, because the tritium is produced, so the number of tritium atom is increased by one through this reaction. However, there is also loss through this second reaction. So that the second reaction is the loss for tritium, okay? What about the helium, D and helium over dt, okay, the time rate of this is again S helium. If some helium gases are injected in the system, we have this. But now look what happens, okay, the first reaction creates one kind of helium, so that it's plus one helium is created, and also okay, but here helium 3, of course, helium 3, right? Helium 3 is more important than alpha particle because it's neutral, but helium 3 is more important. So, but helium 3 is lost. This helium 3 is gone through the third product. So, minus 3 we have to write. Okay. Now, next time we will try to solve these equations by using this kind of reaction rates, and I will show you the solution. Okay. And give you some kind of graphs to show what's happening in the dynamic system. So this is exactly what's happening in some, and we are just analyzing the number of particles in time, how they change, and so on. Okay. So next time, in our next lecture, we will do that. Okay. Good. So this is the end of today's lecture. So I now stop recording. And then I will let you to ask me questions if you have some.